Let us worship God. God shines light into our darkness.
The light of the knowledge of the glory of God.
God places within us a treasure of great worth.
The light of the knowledge of the glory of God.
Let us worship God as we sing together, O worship the King. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Talofa, ifa tasile adi ima oe.
Jesus often uses very down-to-earth images to speak about God's presence in our world. We hear of a woman kneading dough in her kitchen, a man who sells all that he has to buy a field, a merchant who gives up everything to purchase that pearl of great price. In each of these pictures, Jesus speaks about the mystery of God. God's presence is both a gift and something that demands the very best from us. Our patience, our energy, our devotion, our willingness to forgive. God's presence in our lives begins a process of conversion and transformation that makes us more fully bearers of God's image. Let us pray. Holy and merciful God, in Jesus Christ you set your holy reign upon this earth and within your people. So let its coming be like the mustard seed that grows into greatness, and like the leaven that mixes with the grain until the whole becomes greater, to the praise of the triune God, who lives forevermore. Amen.
Let us confess our sins to God. Holy God, we open our hearts to you this day and offer the truth of our lives and fear that stifles us, the prejudice that blinds us, the ignorance that hobbles us, the doubt that plagues us. Help us, we pray, that we will find courage in unlikely places, see the world with new and gracious eyes, move to those places where love is needed, and have faith that you are with us. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
The great love of God is revealed in the Son, who came to this earth to redeem everyone. Hear then Christ's word of grace to us. Your sins are forgiven.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Lord God, our Father, our heart remains restless until it has discovered the peace you offer us in Jesus your Son. Help us to put our trust and joy not in brittle, perishable things, but in your Son, his good news, and the kingdom he came to build among us. Make us receptive. Give each of us an attentive and wise heart that keeps seeking until we have found you in Jesus and love you and rest in you. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Today we hear a story that Jesus told. It's called a parable. Parables are like presents. They have already been given to us, but we can't buy them or take them or steal them. They're ours already, and they're very, very precious. Once there was a man who did such amazing things and did such wonderful things that people began to follow him. And as they followed him, he told them about a kingdom of heaven. However, they didn't understand. So one day they asked, "What is the kingdom of heaven like?" And Jesus told them this story. Here is a man who buys and sells things. He's called a merchant. He has a fine fur coat, a felt hat with a floppy feather. It's his favourite. The house he lives in is huge. It has five floors and a fish pond with a fountain in the front garden. The merchant has everything he wants. He has 15 rooms filled with furniture. He has four freezers full of food and three fridges for fizzy drinks. And there's more money under his mattress than you could ever imagine. Much more. Yes, the merchant has everything he wants, until one day, in the shop window, he sees something special. It's a wonderful white pearl. £500,000, says the man in the shop. It's even more money than the merchant has under his mattress. But he wants that pearl more than anything in the world. He hurries home. He has a plan. He sells his furniture, his fridges, his freezers full of food. He sells his house, his fountain, and his fish pond. He sells his fine fur coat. But the felt hat with the floppy feather he keeps. It's his favourite. He borrows a barrow and bundles in the money and off to the shop he trundles to buy the pearl. Oh dear, he's still £6 short. "Sell me your hat for £6, says the man in the shop. The merchant laughs. He hands the man his hat and he takes the pearl. Hooray, the pearl is his at last. Jesus says, God is like the merchant's pearl. It costs everything to know him, but he's worth more than anything in the world.
Last week, we read about Jacob as a fugitive who in a dream learns that God has not abandoned him, but rather makes the very same promise to him that God made to Abraham. After setting up a cairn to mark his encounter with God as a holy place, Jacob travels on to meet his uncle Laban. Before he does, he stops at a well where shepherds have gathered to water their flocks, and it is there that he first sets eyes on Rachel, Laban's daughter. Jacob waters her flock. Rachel then runs to fetch her father. Let us hear how the story continues. "Lord, bring out your treasure.
What is new and what is old?"
A reading from Genesis chapter 29. Then Laban said to Jacob, "Because you are my kinsman, should you therefore serve me for nothing? Tell me, what shall your wages be?" Now Laban had two daughters. The name of the elder was Leah, and the name of the younger was Rachel. Leah's eyes were lovely, and Rachel was graceful and beautiful. Jacob loved Rachel, so he said, I will serve you 7 years for your younger daughter Rachel. Laban said, It is better that I give her to you than that I should give her to any other man. Stay with me. So Jacob served 7 years for Rachel, and they seemed to him but a few days because of the love he had for her. Then Jacob said to Laban, Give me my wife that I may go into her, for my time is completed. So Laban gathered together all the people of the place and made a feast. But in the evening he took his daughter Leah and brought her to Jacob, and he went in to her. Laban gave his maid Zilpah to his daughter Leah to be her maid. When morning came, it was Leah, and Jacob said to Laban, What is this that you have done to me? Did I not serve with you for Rachel? Why then have you deceived me? Laban said, This is not done in our country, giving the younger before the firstborn. Complete the week of this one, and we will give you the other also in return for serving me another 7 years. Jacob did so and completed her week. Then Laban gave him his daughter Rachel as a wife. Today's psalm, Psalm 105, will be read responsively. O give thanks to the Lord, call on God's name.
Make known God's deeds among the peoples.
Make music and sing of God's goodness.
Tell of all God's wondrous deeds.
Revel in God's holy name.
Delight in seeking the Lord.
Look always for the power.
For the presence of God.
Remember the wonderful works God has done.
The signs, the wonders, and just decrees God has uttered.
You heirs of Abraham and Jacob, the chosen of the Lord.
Give praise to the God of promise.
Our next reading is from the book of Romans, chapter 8, verses 26 to 39. I will read in Psalm 1. O le faitauina o le afioga paia a le atua. Roma, o le ona mataupu, e luasifulu ma le ono o ia valu. O le faiupu e luasifulu ma le ono, seʻia fagata mai le tolusifulu ma le iva. Faafofoga ia o le au faitauina a le afioga a le atua. E faapea foʻi le agaga ona fesoasoani mai lo tatou vaivai. Awa tatou te leiloa mea tatou te ole atu ai ma le tusa. Ai peitaʻi o le agaga. E fautua o ia mo I tatou le oia le mafai ona talatalaina. A o lē suʻesuʻe I loto, ua silafia e ia le finagalo o le agaga. Auā o lou fautua o ia mo le paia e tusa ma le finagalo o le atua. Ua tatou iloa foʻi e galue le atua I mea uma lava mo le lelei faatasi mai latou o ē ua alolofa atu iā te ia. O ē ua valaauina I lona finagalo. Auā o ē na silafia e ia namua, na ia tofia namua foʻi. Ia foliga I latou I lona ala. Ia foliga iā te ia. Ina ia avea o ia maulu matua o le auso e toʻatele. O ē na tofia namua e ia, ua valaauina foʻi I latou e ia. O ē ua valaauina e ia, o ē ua taʻuamiotonuina foʻi I latou. O ē ua taʻuamiotonuina e ia, ua faamanuiaina foʻi I latou e ia. O lenei, seʻase tatou upu I nei lea. Afai ua au mai tatou le atua, o ai se faasagatau mai iā te I tatou. O ia lava sa na le faasaoina lona alo lava, ua tuuina mai o ia, o na o tatou uma lava. E lē foaʻifua mai ea e ia iā I tatou mea uma lava faatasi mai ia I se ā. O ai se na te molia le au filifilia I le atua. O le atua o lē taʻuamiotonuina mai. O ai se na te faasala mai. O Keriso o ia na maliu, a ua toe tū mai lava o ia. O lo le itu tamatau foʻi o le atua, o loʻo fautua foʻi o ia mo I tatou. O ai se na te faateʻaisaina mai tatou le alofa o Keriso. ole poa poa ngā ea, po le atuatu wale, po le sawa, po le onge, po le le lava lava, po le pangatia, po le pelu, whapeo na tūsia, ona o oe wa fasiotia I mātou I asu uma, wa whātauina I mātou e peo mā moe a fasia, a wa tātou manu māloa ia I nei mea umalama, ona o ia wālofa mai a te tātou. A wāwa mauti noa, ele mawhai a leoti, po leola, po angelu, po alii, po e malolosi, po mea nei ona po, po mea atali, po le mawalunga, po le loloto, po se tasi mea na whai, ele mawhai a mea ona whate te se ina mai tātou, ele alofa o le atua. O loo ia ke riso Jesu, lo tātou wale. Ia whamanu ia tele mai le atua I whaitau wina o na nā whia mopai. Nei mai o hui whaavau, whaavau nā.
From the Holy Gospel of Matthew, chapter 13. He, Jesus, put before them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like a mustard seed that someone took and sowed in his field. It is the smallest of all seeds, but when it has grown, it is the greatest of shrubs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and make nests in its branches. He told them another parable. The kingdom of heaven is like yeast that a woman took and mixed in with 3 measures of flour until all of it was leavened. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid. Then, in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and caught fish of every kind. When it was full, they drew it ashore, sat down, and put the good into baskets, but threw out the bad. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all this? They answered, yes. And he said to them, therefore every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like the master of a household who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old. Lord, open our eyes to your presence and fill our hearts with praise.
Let us pray. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. One of the most profound messages of the Christian faith is that God is prepared to enter into the messiness of our lives. That's the message of Christmas, of God coming to us in the birth of Jesus. And birth itself is messy and at times a painful business. Yes, there is wonder and joy as well, but we can't avoid the mess. Some of the most powerful moments of wonder and mystery in my life have been about the birth of my children, the privilege of being there to support my wife through the hours of waiting, her labour, her pain, and then the sound of a baby's cry, remarkable physical presence of this tiny baby, so precious, so wanted, so loved. Yes, there is mess, there is exhaustion and pain, but there is also wonder and at the mystery of life and a deep gratitude. And God is in the midst of it all. We see that in the story of Jacob as he travels from that cairn he built at the place where he dreamt of heaven and earth linked in some mysterious way by an unseen passage or stairway. The memory remains overwhelming and awe-inspiring, and with the enduring words of God's promise echoing in his mind, he moves on to Haran. And as he approaches his destination, Jacob finds himself at a well with shepherds gathered around in no great rush, enjoying each other's company. And it's then that Rachel arrives leading her father's sheep. Rachel is Laban's daughter, and she's a real stunner, and Jacob falls for her immediately. It's rare in these ancient texts to find romantic passion expressed so warmly as it is here. Jacob is in love, so much in love, that he's willing to work for Laban for 7 years in order to marry her. And when we hear that, we might begin to reassess what we think of Jacob the deceiver. He's a passionate romantic, so there must be something good about it. But then comes the irony. At the end of 7 years, the wedding celebrations begin, and Laban has gathered everyone from around the district to come and join in the fun. It's a night of feasting and dancing, good food and wine, and in the morning Jacob wakes up to find himself bedded with Leah, not Rachel. Jacob the deceiver finds himself on the other end of the stick, cruelly robbed of what he had wanted most, deceived big time by his uncle. The trickster has been tricked, and it can't be undone because everyone was witness to this wedding. What a mess. What chaos and anger and humiliation surge together in Jacob. And how could a father do this to his daughter? To give her in marriage to a man who wants her sister. It's a recipe for disaster, if ever there was. I can only imagine God watching behind the scenes, astounded at the tangled web of deceit that so marks the human family. The powerful message of this story is how God works through human messiness to bring order out of chaos, always seeking to restore us, heal and forgive us, so that we might shine to reflect the very love of God that holds us firm. There will be more pain and anguish in this story as Jacob also marries Rachel, the love of his life. For now there is competition between the sisters, especially when Leah has children, and Rachel, despite her beauty, is at first not able to have children. Not yet. Sometimes we might be tempted to look at other families and that seem so perfect and wish that ours were not so fraught with tensions and tragedies of various kinds. But believe me, every family has struggles from time to time. And when we read this story, it's not hard to find connections with our own life experiences. I imagine Jacob in all his fury, shirt-fronting Laban in the early dawn light. Why did you deceive me? These were the very same words that Isaac used to describe Jacob's behavior in taking Esau's blessing. Is this event telling us that we will always need to face the consequences of our actions? Or is something else happening in this story that we haven't yet seen? The verb to love doesn't appear very often in the book of Genesis. The emotions of its characters are often hidden from us, so that when they're revealed, they have great literary force. The word love appears three times in relation to Jacob's feelings for Rachel. And later on we find the storyteller telling us again three times that Jacob loved Rachel's son Joseph more than any of his other sons. Love is a powerful bond that carries with it deep emotions. But if the feelings get out of hand and not balanced by good judgment, love is diminished and things go wrong. Thomas Merton, the Trappist monk and author of many influential books on Christian spiritual practice, wrote in a very significant book on the power and meaning of love. In that book he says that love is the key to the meaning of life. And helpfully speaks of love not simply in terms of romance or feeling. Feelings run hot and cold, and love, if it is true, doesn't control or want to hold the other as a possession or an object. Paul's definition of love in 1 Corinthians as patience, kindness, not jealous or boastful, not arrogant or rude, which bears all things, believes all things, and endures all things, gives contours to how we as Christians understand love. In many ways, Paul's definition speaks a lot about Jesus, about God, who is love. Love in biblical terms has two sides, love and justice. Without justice, love is insufficient to sustain us, insufficient to maintain peace within a family, as Jacob soon discovers and pays heavily for it. Love is not enough, for it leaves the less loved feeling unloved, and the result is conflict and sometimes tragedy. Rabbi Jonathan Sacks writes that for love to be true, there must be justice, fairness, and a regard for how our sentiments impact on others. Without justice, love is blind, but without love, justice is impersonal and cold. Jacob's family needed both, and so do we. The story Jesus tells of a trader whose business was searching for fine pearls speaks both of the joy and the cost of love. Jacob knew both. The trader finds something of infinite value and sells all he has to get it. We might think him reckless, if not mad. We might think his priorities skewed. But this man had found something of great wonder and beauty and wanted it more than anything else in the world. His investment, his commitment is total and complete because the pearl is beyond price. Love demands everything from us, and that's partly what is so profound about it. Discovering the life and love of God brings great joy and richness to our lives, yet also demands the very best from us. It leads us to grow through the messiness of our lives, learning from our mistakes, to do justice, love kindness, and to walk humbly with God.
Thank you.
Heavenly Father, accept the offering we seek to make of ourselves and our money, and grant that we may ever work and pray to build a world of peace and joy and freedom through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Prayers of Intercession. Heavenly Father, you have made us for yourself, and you alone can satisfy our needs. Hear our prayers for the Church and for your world. Source of all wisdom, we pray for the leaders of nations. As we live under the shadow of this virus, give them courage and wisdom to govern all their peoples, to protect the vulnerable, care for our planet Earth, and foster just processes that promote harmony and peace across the globe. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for the family of your Church, for all who preach and guide people into faith. We pray for St. John's, for Sayu Leota, his leadership team, and for the families that make up the Samoan cluster. We ask that you bless and keep them safe and well. We pray for those among us who come from other countries, like from Chile, Korea, Iran, Malaysia, Germany, China, India, and the USA. Especially we pray for the congregations of St. John's and Wesley in Bangalore and the churches of South India. Sustain us all in faith in these difficult times. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O God, our refuge, be present now to people who need your loving touch. For those who are lonely and isolated because of COVID-19, may they know the comfort of your peace. For teachers under so much pressure to deliver good education online, give them wisdom, patience, creativity, and the energy they need. Prompt worn-out parents to speak words of kindness and encouragement to their children. For health workers in emergency departments on the front line, protect them from harm. For scientists working on a vaccine, give them inspiration and persistence. As people feel financial strain during the uncertainty of these days, bring them comfort and peace, reminding them that you are there for them. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
And now in silence, we hold up to you those we love. Faithful God, search out our hearts and lead us in the way everlasting, that we, with all your saints, may enter the gate of heaven and dwell forever in your presence. We make our prayers through Jesus our Redeemer. Amen. I invite you now to join me in the language of your birth, the prayer that Jesus taught us, the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen.